All right. Well, let's hope it works this time. This is the second time I've made this video, so a little bit of a recording error. As I said in the previous video, we're going to be looking at different sections of this mock test for you, and we're going to be going through solutions for the different parts. This first video is going to be solutions to these 10 true-false questions that you see on the screen right now. So we'll go ahead and get started. The instructions read, for numbers 1 through 10, each statement is either true or false. Write true or T in the blank if the statement is true. Otherwise, write F for false. No explanations are required. So you don't need to, on this mock test, there's no need to write explanations. This could be a question type on the real test too. So this would be, this is a section where guessing is to your benefit. You got a 50-50 shot at getting a question right. And when you get it right, you don't need to tell me why you're right. You just get it right or wrong. Each correct answer is worth 2 points. So this is 20 points. If I remember correctly, this test was out of 100. So this is 20% of the test. All right, so we'll get started on number one. And this question right away, just to make the solution known, is false. It says the interval from 4 to 10, including 4, but not including 10, is the same set of numbers as the set of all numbers x such that 4 is less than or equal to the number which is less than or equal to 10. So if we graph this on a number line, let's graph the interval. Here's 4, and we can include that. Here's 10, we can't include that. And it's this interval here. So if I picked a random number in here, well, it's going to be greater than or equal to 4, but it has to be less than 10. So this interval is not the same as this set of numbers, because that set has one more number in it. It's got 10. Number 2, the x-intercepts of y equals x squared minus 1 are the points 1, 0 and negative 1, 0. This one's true. The reason is we can quickly solve for these zeros. So this equation y has x-intercepts whenever the height y is 0. So we'll set this equal to 0 and we'll solve. So this is what we're setting equal to 0, which is something that we can factor. It's x minus 1, x plus 1. Okay. Well, I see two quick solutions. The left factor says that x equals 1 is a solution. And the right factor says x equals negative 1 is a solution. What that means is if we plug in 1, we get a height of 0, which means we've got ourselves an x-intercept. The second solution, negative 1, says when we plug in negative 1, we get a height of 0. So what we've got going on here is the two x-intercepts. That's true. 3, the domain of f of x equals square root of x squared plus 1 is all real numbers. This is true as well. If we look at what's underneath this radical sign, we just need to make sure that whatever we plug in does not give us a negative sign underneath the radical, right? We can't have a negative number underneath the radical in this course of study. So let's think about it. We're squaring the input and then we're adding 1. Well, if we square a negative number, what do we get? We get a positive number. If we square 0, we get 0. If we square a positive number, we still have a positive number. So no matter what we plug in, we're going to get a non-negative number, and then we're going to make it bigger by 1. So we still have non-negatives. In fact, we definitely have positive numbers at this point. So this is true. No matter what you plug in, any real number, you can take the square of it, add 1 to it, and then square root that positive result. Number 4, according to the equation x minus 1 plus y squared equals 9, y is a function of x. Okay, so what we're asking here is, if you plug in an x, is there just one possible answer? If you plug in an x, is there just one possible answer? Now, you could go about solving this a few different ways. You could solve this for y, in which case you would get y equals plus or minus 10 minus x underneath the square root sign. And that right there, in fact, this plus or minus will tell you this is not a function. You've got a problem there where you plug in any x and you get either the positive radical of that 10 minus x or you get the negative. You get both. So for one input, you get two outputs. Another way you could think about this problem is bringing, you know, maybe that one to the other side and you get x minus y squared is 10. Maybe you don't solve it all the way. And now you think about it. And you think, if I plug in 1x, I don't know, like, let's say plug in negative, no, let's plug in 19. Let's plug in 19. What do we get? We get 19 minus y squared is 10. Well, what are the possibilities for y? You had 19 and you want to subtract a number and you need to get 10. Well, the number needs to be 9, right? So this means that y squared must equal 9. But if y squared is 9, what's y? Well, it's either plus or minus 3. So y is not a function of x. We plugged in 1x. We got two y's that made it true. That's not a function. Is x a function of y? Yes. Think about that for a minute. Is x a function of y? Yes. You plug in one y, you get one x. But y is not a function of x. Because you plug in one x, you get two y's. Okay, number 5, relative to any function f, the function f of x minus 3 minus 4 is shifted left 3 and down 4. So I like this part. I like that the down 4 is correct, this subtraction of 4. But this left 3 is actually incorrect. But before I explain that, just real quick again, what we're saying is if you take any old function and then you do these things to it, you subtract 3 from the input, plug that in. Then you subtract 4 from the output. What this is saying is that this function is identical to this other one, except that it's just been shifted a little bit on the plane. It's no longer in the same place, but it has the exact same shape. You haven't stretched it, you haven't bent it, you haven't done anything weird, except you've slid it on the graph somewhere, on the plane somewhere. So this problem is suggesting that it's down 4, which is correct, but that it's also left 3, and that's incorrect. This is x minus 3. Students often confuse this subtraction with moving things to the left, because that's the negative side of the real line. But we need to remember that things are actually flipped when you're talking about the input there. So when you subtract 3, you're actually shifting the graph right 3. And I've explained this before, this is because we're taking the real number line and we're moving it to the right, sorry, to the left, 3. And that has the effect of the graph actually being placed to the right. Okay, so this is false. Number 6, for any x and y, we have x minus y squared is x squared plus y squared. This is totally false. Totally false. But this is a common mistake that students make, which is why it's in here. Let's just pick two numbers and see if we can make this wrong. We could actually FOIL this out, but I don't care to take that time. Here it is. This is what, I will take the time. Here it is. It's x squared minus 2xy plus y squared. That is not x squared plus y squared. But we could also just pick some numbers, like 1. Let's let x equal 1 and y equal 1. on the left side, we get 0 squared. On the right side, what do we get? We get 1 plus 1, which is 2. Is 2 0? No. So for number 6, you could either FOIL it, or you could pick some numbers, or you could just remember that this is just not right. Something's not right here. Powers don't factor through. They don't always factor through polynomials like this. Number 7, for any x and y, we have that product of x minus y and x plus y is x squared minus y squared. This is true. This is one of those perfect perfect factorization things that we memorized. And if you multiply this out, it is true. X times x is x squared. Minus y times y is minus y squared. Now let's look at what happens to the other ones. We get x times positive y. So that's plus xy. And then we get minus y times x. These two cancel out. So we're left with exactly x squared minus y squared. Number 8. This is an easy one to find a counterexample to. It is false. You can't just split denominators like this. It takes a good deal of effort to split denominators out, something that you'll learn. You'll spend a lot of time learning in calculus, but you can't just split denominators like this. But let's find some counterexamples. So we're saying that 3 over x minus 1 is equal to 3 over x minus 3 over 1 for any real number except 0 or 1. Now that's here to try and say, hey, if we plug in 1, we get a 0 here in this denominator, so we can't have that. And the 0 here can't have that, because that gives us a 0 in this denominator. This is just to like try and give it a little more credibility, even though it is false. So let's just plug in some numbers. And you don't have to try many. You can pick a small number or a big number, it doesn't matter. How about we just pick negative 1? Or 2? Or 3? These pretty much all work. Okay, so on the left-hand side, let's just pick, I don't know, negative 1. 3 over negative 1 minus 1 is 3 over negative 2. So it's negative 3 halves. On the right side, we get 3 over negative 1 minus 3 over 1. 3 over negative 1 is negative 3. And negative 3 over 1 is negative 3. So this is minus 6. That is definitely not equal to negative 3 halves. So this is not true for any real number x except 0 or 1, because we just found one. Negative 1 doesn't work. Like I said, you could pick lots and lots of others. You could pick 2, you could pick 3. I challenge you to find the number that makes this true. Number 9. The equation 0 equals negative x squared plus 2x minus 3 has no real solutions. It's a more challenging question. It has no real solutions. Well, how do we solve problems like this? Well, by saying this quadratic has no solutions, what we're saying is that it doesn't cross the x-axis. So we could check where the vertex of this guy is. We could see if its height is above the x-axis. If its height is above the x-axis, this is false, because this is a negative leading coefficient, which means it looks like this. So if the vertex is above the x-axis, it does have real solutions. But if the vertex is below the x-axis, it does not have any solutions. That's one way you could do it. Another way you could do it is you could plug this into the quadratic formula. You can see what you get. And really here you just need to check the discriminant. Remember that. If you get a negative number underneath the discriminant, as the discriminant, there's no real solutions. And that's going to be the method that I use because it's the simplest. Okay. So the discriminant, remember, is b squared minus 4ac. In the whole quadratic formula, that's underneath the square root, if you remember. Here, what's b? B is 2. So this is 4 minus 4 times a. What's a? A is negative 1. Times c. What is c? C is negative 3. So what is this? This is 4 minus, so here we have, that's a negative 1, I believe, yep. Okay, that's negative 4 times negative 1, that's positive 4, times negative 3, now we're at negative 12, so 4 minus 12. This is negative 8. So the discriminant is negative 8. So when we take the square root of that in the quadratic formula, we get imaginary numbers. This is the solutions to this are actually complex numbers. So this is definitely true. So this, like I said, that's one way. Another way is to check the vertex, which is the opposite of b over 2a. So the vertex is at a coordinate of x equals 1. That's the vertex. And then to plug that in. When we plug that in, we get negative 1. Just separate this out a little bit. When we plug the vertex in, we get the opposite of 1 squared, so that's negative 1 plus 2 minus 3. And that overall is negative 2. That's below the x-axis. And since this opens downwards, our quadratic never crosses the x-axis. So there's no real solutions. Number 10, the real solutions to this absolute value of x minus 5 less than or equal to 2 form a single interval on the real line. And this one's true. Just, you could think of it just by inspection, or you can think of it by the definition of the absolute value. So one way to remember the absolute value is distance. The absolute value of x minus 5 says that the distance between x and 5, that's what that is less than or equal to 2. So I mean, think about the real number line. Here's 5. Pick any x, and the only x's you're allowed to pick are the ones that are less than or equal to 2 from 5. So you could go up to 7, because that's 2 above, or you could go down to 3. Any of those numbers is totally allowed, so long as the distance between these, the random number you pick between 3 and 7, and then the number 5, as long as that distance, right, is less than or equal to 2, it's a solution. It solves this inequality. It makes a true statement. So the real solutions are this interval from 3 to 7 inclusive. So that's 3 to 7. These are the solutions. And that's one interval. Okay, so in the next couple videos, I'm going to be making solutions to that was interesting. The remaining problems on the test, I can't scroll down and show any of them to preview them yet, but we'll be going through more solutions of different problems for this upcoming exam on Thursday and Friday. So that's the true false with complete explanations, and I hope that helps in your studies. So good luck. I'll see you in the next one.